Hello and welcome to Original Soundchat, where video game music is a work of art. On each episode, it's our goal to help you learn about two soundtracks from the world of games, as well as the people, stories, and critical tracks behind them. My name is Joe DeVader.
And I'm Peter Spezia. We're brought to you by Anonymous Dinosaur and Rhymes with Asia. It's time to appreciate great OSTs and the games behind them without getting too bogged down in music theory. Joe, what are this week's games?
Up first is a mobile game that attempts to portray the struggles of being stuck in a rut in your mid-20s, 2018's Florence.
Following that is 2013's Fire Emblem Awakening, the last-ditch effort to save a classic strategy RPG series, which opened itself to newcomers and even a little bit of love. That's right, the theme this week is relationships, and it's a fitting theme for both games, but I think they're just totally different in terms of scale, one being a very short mobile game, the other a beefy chess-on-crack RPG. apologies for the different quality settings coming from my end this week. You've caught me here in a business trip out in Golden, Colorado, the home of the Coors Brewing Company. So, Mac webcam, you know, on-the-road Yeti. Microphone, not as good as usual, but apologies for making it work here. Joe, how you doing?
I mean, it's okay, because if they need something to cling to, I'm still in my room.
There you go. But yeah, your game this week, it's a doozy on the emotional level, and so I'm really interested to hear you talk about this game here today.
And I'm very excited to talk about it, to be perfectly honest. Even though I have no idea how it's actually going to go. But let's do this. Alright. Florence was originally released on iOS on February 14th, 2018. That's right, Valentine's Day.
Aww.
On Android exactly 1 month later.
Which, Pi Day?
Yeah, Pi Day, I guess? I don't know. I don't think there's any pie in Florence, but...
Mince pie?
I don't think so. I think curry is the only thing we ever see made in Florence.
Yeah, that's probably true.
The game was developed by Australian studio Mountains, which is a studio that was founded by Ken Wong after he had found success at his previous studio, OSTs, who are the developers of Monument Valley, which is another very good mobile game. If you have never played it, I definitely recommend it. He served as a designer and artist on that game. Wong felt like he had done everything he could at OSTs and decided that what he would rather do is set off and make his own studio. So he went back to his home country of Australia, ended up in Melbourne, where he founded Mountains. And then they hired their staff before they really even had an idea of what game they were going to make, because Wong had a philosophy of hiring first and then coming up with a solid idea second, which is really weird when you think about it in terms of video games, because that would only work with a game of this scale.
Yeah, you don't see like a AAA game of 100 people be like, all right, so now what? Let's take all the team's, you know, feedback and create something. But yeah, for a smaller indie mobile game, it makes sense. It worked, obviously. And yeah, you're absolutely right with Monument Valley. I mean, gosh, what an accomplishment of a mobile game. So this just continues that trend.
And I feel like it's also a really good idea, because one of the big bummers of working in video games is that most of the time you're going to be working on somebody else's cool idea and not your own. And in this way, I bet the whole team just sort of felt like they all had a part in coming up with the idea, which is cool.
Yeah, good camaraderie. Must have helped the development process.
So they all sat down and talked about how the portrayal of love and human emotions in media, like movies or books or video games, is kind of hard. It's a lot harder in video games. Video games tend to fall short a lot of the time, because it's very rare you're going to find a game where something like that is the central premise, the central focus of the game. And so they decided that going in with that would be a good challenge, making a game where human emotions and relationships and things like that is the central premise of the game. And so work on Florence began. Now you might be wondering, what is Florence? Well, I'm actually doing things in the opposite order we would usually do them for this for a reason. I'm going to get through the developer story and then we will talk about the game itself. So the game was put on mobile specifically because they wanted to make it as accessible to everybody as humanly possible, which when we talk about mobile games, people that play games tend to look down on them because, look, I'm not going to mince words here. Most mobile games are garbage. A majority of mobile games are very, very bad. But the thing everybody forgets is that everybody has a phone. Everyone. That makes it the most accessible platform for video games that currently exists. And do most developers of mobile games squander that fact? Boy, howdy, they sure do. But there are good examples, shiny examples, and it's important to point them out. Stuff like Florence or Monument Valley or...
I mean, Super Mario Run is always one that, you know, kind of got a little short-shifted with, you know, paying for a quality game that didn't rely on microtransactions. And then, you know, it's the race to the bottom in terms of pricing for mobile games. Because, yeah, you're right. So often it's the predatory practices, you know, kind of trying to leech on the quote-unquote whales or whatever people want to, you know, call certain customers. You're right. It's all the more reason why certain quality examples of mobile games should be highlighted. And not just like it's a port of Final Fantasy VI and we're going to, you know, make the graphics too saccharine. Like, no, like original games designed with the platform specifically in mind. And we'll get to talking about that with Florence here, but it's important to talk about these kind of games.
Mm-hmm. I agree. The team decided they wanted to create an experience similar to a comic book or a silent movie. I think they came closer to the first one than the second, but you can definitely see aspects of both. And they wanted a full focus on narrative, cited films such as 500 Days of Summer, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, and Titanic, I guess, as inspirations for the game.
I don't know about Titanic, but you can definitely see the fingerprints of 500 Days of Summer all over this one. Don't know if you've ever seen the movie. You know, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Zooey Deschanel, they're a good pair. It's, but like, if there's one movie that is a good parallel, it's definitely 500 Days. Eternal Sunshine, maybe kind of, but definitely 500 Days of Summer.
I'll take your word for it. I've never seen any of those three films. So, the game is a linear experience specifically because the developers felt that if they gave the player too much choice or too many branching paths, most players would just sort of default to the morally correct option and then miss the moral of the story completely. Which, I guess, yeah, also allowed them to be more focused in where they were going and the story they wanted to tell. Not every game needs to be The Walking Dead. Not every game needs to be Until Dawn or Heavy Rain, which we talked about last week. Sometimes they can just be a beginning to end story.
And yeah, certain games like the ones you mentioned certainly benefit from, you know, oh, what was your choice? Well, mine was this, and I played over hours, and that's not what this is.
Yeah, and again, not every game needs to be that, and Florence works very well with it. So, which brings us to, this game is super cheap, costs $3. I'm pretty sure I got it for $2.50.
Oh my gosh, what a bargain.
And it can be played in about 20 to 30 minutes. I replayed Florence while researching for this show. Do you know how many games I've done for this show that I can say that about? Zero, except for Florence.
I think all the more reason why, you know, there is little excuse for people to go out, try a game that's meant for mobile games at this price, at this short, you know, investment of time. And yeah, like I said, it'll hit you right in the emotions. Like, it's an important game about interpersonal relationships.
Yes. And for this reason, I kind of recommend that before you listen to the rest of this section, Either stop listening to the show right now or just use the timestamps to move on to the second game. Play Florence first. Because A, you should just play Florence, and B, it's kind of hard to talk about a game when it's 20 to 30 minutes long without talking about the entire game.
Yeah, yeah. No, absolutely. Definitely check it out.
So, that is my warning. From here, we're just going to go ahead and talk as if we've all played the game. The game follows Florence Yeo, a 25-year-old woman working as an accountant in Melbourne, Australia, a job she very clearly does not enjoy all that much. She is kind of just stuck in a rut. She is 25. She's me! and just stuck in this dead-end job that she doesn't enjoy, dealing with an overbearing mother, living by herself, stuck in this routine. Fun fact, according to Wong, the name Florence was chosen specifically because she was meant to be Chinese-Australian in lineage. Both of her parents are meant to be Chinese immigrants to Australia. And the implication is that her parents picked an old-fashioned name for her when they immigrated.
And that's interesting that you mentioned that, you know, it was supposed to be Chinese-Australian. Like, I mean, I get it. Like, Australian developer, write and develop to what you know, makes total sense. Wasn't something I picked up on while playing.
The game never makes any mention that it actually takes place in Melbourne. I only know it because I did research.
Yeah, and so I think it just speaks to the universality of, you know, the story that they're trying to tell. And there's nothing that really gets in the way of saying, we're different than where you might be.
One day, while walking down the street, Florence's phone battery dies, which means that she can't listen to her music on her headphones. And this leads to her hearing a cello player, a cellist, if you will. She hears a cellist playing on the street, a street performer, and pretty much immediately falls in love. But she doesn't meet this performer until she crashes her bike in front of him a few days later. Which is a very fun moment, in my opinion. Though I'm not, I think it might be my least favorite gameplay-wise with the focusing the images.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't like the gameplay of that part, but overall, very good scene. The performer's name turns out to be Krish Hemrajani, and he gives Florence his number, and the two start to go on a number of dates. And this sequence actually might contain one of my favorite examples of abstraction in any game I've ever played. Now, you might be asking yourself, Joe, what's abstraction? You can't just use terms and pretend they're real. Well, this one's real. Abstraction is the act of taking something and distilling it into just what you need to get the message across in your game. So, as a good example, think Cooking Mama. Cooking is not actually that easy. Cooking Mama just makes it look easy because it gives you just what you need to be able to fill in the blanks yourself. Another very good example that while I was researching to make sure I got the correct term, because I couldn't remember. I knew I had learned about this in school, but I couldn't actually remember if abstraction was the right term. The example I read was turn-based battles. So think, you play Persona 4, and then you watch Persona 4 the animation. And obviously, in the show, the shadows aren't just sitting there waiting for Yu Narukami to decide what kind of attack he's gonna use. There's an actual battle going on, but in the game, it's turn-based, you can take your time, strategize and all that, but we let that pass because we know what it's supposed to be. Our brains can fill in the blanks and say, oh, this is supposed to be a fight. It's just, this is how it works in this game.
Yeah, yeah, any turn-based combat, Pokemon, JRPG, yeah, for sure.
Mm-hmm. So in Florence's case, this abstraction comes in the form of a metaphor where Florence and Krish are on their date and talking, and Krish will say something. Of course, there's no voice acting. This is all represented through graphics and music. Krish will say something, and then you will have to do a small little puzzle, put together a bunch of puzzle pieces into a speech bubble, which then, when it's complete, Florence will say something. And every time you do this, the puzzles have fewer and fewer pieces, and they end up being a lot easier until eventually you're just putting a fully completed speech bubble into the thing, and she's saying it because Florence is getting increasingly comfortable talking to Krish.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a good way of portraying that.
Yeah. And of course, it goes back to mobile game design, where you're touching and dragging these pieces over. It's not a, you know, motion control point or a analog stick and button press. Like, no, it's very tactile. It's very clear and simple what you're meant to do.
Yeah, Florence is full of these things. This game can be played by literally anybody. I could hand this game to my grandmother and she'd be able to play it. You could hand it to a child. The child would not understand anything that is happening on screen, but you could hand it to a child and they could play it.
Oh, they could beat it for sure.
Because it's all just, every single chapter has its own little gimmick and it's all touch-based, very intuitive stuff. Just well-designed so that anybody can play it. Florence and Krish officially begin a relationship that leads to Florence pushing Krish to apply to the Academy of Music, which he makes it in because his dream is to be a professional cellist. And this kind of leads her to realize that she doesn't really have a dream of her own until Krish gifts her with a set of paints as thanks for, hey, thank you for pushing me into doing this. And this kind of leads her to realize, oh, I want to be an artist. But she still doesn't actually, like, go for that for a while. The two end up moving in together, and they're overall very happy, until they're not. After 1 year, the two start to realize that they're falling back into a routine, and they begin drifting apart. And the game follows from this point to a big fight to the breakup, which has another one of my favorite sort of moments. After the big fight has another one of my favorite moments of abstraction where you are presented with a bunch of puzzle pieces. Once again, it's portraying this with puzzles. And it's them laying in bed facing away from each other. And once you get the two put together, you realize that the two halves don't fit together in the same puzzle anymore. And it's just a very powerful visualization, and it's fantastic, fantastically done. Krish eventually moves out, and Florence is, of course, a mess for a little while, but eventually begins pouring her passion into painting, and eventually ends up being an artist, like a professional artist, who has like shows at galleries and everything. And it's just a beautifully told narrative about finding love, moving on, losing love, all that kind of thing. It's just a fantastic game that if you listened to that and didn't play it, look, man, I don't know what to tell you now. Play it. Go play it.
Yeah, this game means quite a bit to me because I played this at the end of 2018. And, you know, it's really powerful, quick and easy game to play. And then 2 weeks later, my life fell apart. So, yeah, like going back and kind of revisiting this hurts, but it is uplifting at the end of it. And so, like, there are good morals to teach from it. And like you said, I mean, if there was going to be a way to pick the right moral choices and you'd avoid the big breakup. Like what would a player learn from that? Mm-hmm. You're not learning the ultimate lesson from it. So yeah, like this game is very memorable for how short it is, but like it leaves your mark on you. Sometimes timing makes it even worse. And then, the soundtrack in particular is just especially memorable as well.
But before we get into that, I do want to mention that the game did receive very favorable reviews upon release. It's got a Metacritic score currently sitting at 82 out of 100. and it won multiple awards, such as Best Mobile Game at the Game Developer's Choice Awards, where Mountains also happens to have won Best Debut. It won Portable Game of the Year at the DICE Awards, won Best Mobile Game at the Game Awards in 2018, and it was nominated for a ton more than that. I would be here for an hour if I told you every single award that it was nominated for.
The game, absolutely worthy of all that recognition.
Now, the person behind the music, because, as you mentioned, the music is very, very good, is one Kevin Penkin. Now, Kevin Penkin was born on May 22nd, 1992. He was born the same year as me. That hurts. in the UK. However, he grew up in Perth, Australia. And he actually mentions a very specific song when asked what gave him an interest in doing game music, and that is Fendrana Drifts from Metroid Prime.
Oh, my man, I like him even more already.
Which I have not heard because I haven't played Metroid Prime.
Oh, oh my god. Oh, you just broke my brain.
Oh, don't you worry. I'll hear it when we get there for Smash Pieces. I'm going to be playing Metroid Prime for the first time in my life. That is, however, the name I hear when people are talking about Metroid Prime music is always Fendrana Drifts.
Such a special tune.
So I'm very much looking forward to hearing that song for the first time. He says that overall, though, as a kid, he found his influences mainly coming from Japanese sources, such as Nobuo Uematsu and Joe Hisaishi, as well as the scores of things like Shadow of the Colossus, which will absolutely be a game we eventually talk about, I'm sure, and Ghost in the Shell. In 2015, he graduated from the Royal College of Music in London with a master's degree in composition for screen, but his career had already gotten a rolling start before that, because in 2011, he had already done his first compositions for a few short films, but had also that same year already collaborated with Nobuo Uematsu for the first time on a game called Juzengi Engetsu Sangokuden, which I've never heard of. Man, I just graduated high school that year, and this dude was already working with Uematsu.
Wow. Yeah, that's something. And yeah, we talked on Uematsu's episode that, you know, the long in development kickstarted Project Phoenix, Uematsu and Kevin Penkin also collaborated for that, apparently. So quite an individual to get paired up with on collaborations so early in a budding career.
Oh, and those aren't even the only two things that he collaborated with Uematsu on, because he also collaborated with him on a game called Norn 9 and a game called Defender's Quest 2 Mists of Ruin. Never heard of either of those games either, but he worked on them with Uematsu.
Norn 9, I feel like I've heard of. It might be an Uchikoshi game, or at least an inspired Zero Escape sort of game. I feel like that's where I've heard it before.
Well, point is, Project Phoenix is actually the fourth game he has worked on with Uematsu. He also doesn't just write for video games. He is nowadays a little bit more well-known for writing for anime, which is a specific result of him working on Norn 9 with Uematsu, because Norn 9 was eventually turned into an anime, and they brought in Penkin to do the music. And through that anime, he developed a very good working relationship with a studio called Kinema Citrus. And he wound up working on their other projects, most notably Made in Abyss. I have to mention that, or our friend, a different Matt, not the Smasher Pieces Matt, but a different Matt, will actually kill me if I don't. Unlike his childhood, he says that nowadays his influences are a lot more 50-50 when it comes to being Western or Japanese, and specifically cites the soundtracks of Final Fantasy XIII and Journey as being big sources of inspiration. Which, again, both very good soundtracks that eventually we will probably talk about. Probably 13 before Journey, because we've already talked about Austin Wintory, but yeah, we will bring Journey eventually.
Yeah.
And he says that he has a minimalistic tendency when it comes to writing, with a lot of love for taking a few core ideas and transforming them over and over again to have new emotional depth every time you hear those ideas, which you can definitely hear in the soundtrack of Florence for sure.
So, just for clarification, Nor 9 is an otome game, being a maiden game that is targeted towards women, where it's like, it's a dating kind of simulator with multiple male subjects and the female playable character. So, not related to Zero Escape at all, but it's very visual novel heavy, and so maybe there was the connection there.
Interesting. Well, it got turned into an anime, so it must have been at least semi... No, then again, Caligula. Caligula got turned into an anime. What am I talking about?
Oh, yeah, it's something I had heard of before, just couldn't peg it.
Like I said, in his discography, he's mainly known for anime nowadays, including a show called Under the Dog, which I guess was an independent anime funded on Kickstarter. His most recent anime work is the show Rising of Shield Hero, which is another of the million isekai shows being piled onto the ground. I haven't watched either of those. I haven't watched Made in Abyss yet either. It is by far his most well-known soundtrack. It even won Best Score at the 2017 Crunchyroll Anime Awards. That one I do plan on watching, hopefully soon, because it did get a dub. As for games, the only other game that I could find that is worth mentioning that wasn't mentioned earlier on the show is a game called Necrobarista, which is apparently a visual novel that is actually set to release on PC in just a few weeks, with console releases to follow in 2020. Which I've heard the name Necrobarista, but I don't actually know what it's about. But I have heard the name, so...
Is it like you're serving coffee to the dead?
I don't think so, but maybe. I have no idea. I'm going to have to look more into it, because if he's doing the music, I'm interested.
That'd be really cool if it was something almost like Valhalla, but not with alcohol. Zombies. Yeah, with zombies and you're doing mixes of blends of coffee.
That would be interesting. I don't think it's that, but that would be interesting. As for some historical development research into the game itself, within the game, Florence is overall represented by a piano. So like when Florence is saying stuff, usually a piano will play to signify that. Or when a theme is specifically about Florence, it'll be played mainly with a piano, usually with a little bit of like violin thrown into. While Krish is, as one would expect, because he's a cellist, represented by a cello.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, this was an accident.
Oh.
So they accidentally stumbled into this sort of dynamic and then used it for the rest of the game. Like, the entire game isn't an accident. But apparently, when they were putting together the fight chapter, it just so happened that they ended up using a piano for when Florence spoke and a cello for when Krish spoke, and then realized, oh, you know what? That's actually kind of a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Let's use that. So I found that really funny that was an accidental thing. But also something I really, really liked, the fact that it's another one of those, oh, that makes me really emotional. I like that. While recording the soundtrack, Penkin reached out to friends from his music conservatory days to perform the music, one of whom was his former flute instructor. And according to him, it was one of the best experiences of his life to hear his music being performed live by these people.
Oh, man. I'm just thinking of the flute parts. And yeah. That just gives it like even more meaning. Wow.
Yeah, it's so cool. It's super cool. But let's dive in to some critical tracks, because we've already talked enough about the game that you could have played the entire game by now. What other game could we possibly talk about that's going to have that be the case? We have to start with, I mean, there's no other song I could start with. Main theme of the game, Florence. Again, main theme of the game, It's a lighthearted piece that is played as a duet between a piano and a cello, with, again, a lot of violin stuff. Again, used to represent Florence and Krish and the relationship they're going to have throughout the course of this game. And it's just a really nice piece. This plays on the title screen, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there's anything else I can say about it other than it's a very nice... It doesn't have any, like, moment attached to it, so there's really nothing more I can say about it.
Yeah, no narrative moment, but at the same time, it's like when you boot up the game, it's one of these songs, like, how do I put this? When you go back to a soundtrack and you hear a song and it's just like, oh, yeah. Like, you immediately remember it. Like, it feels like a classic song to you. Like, if you can remember a tune, a melody, based on hearing it, and it just represents that work for you, like, that's what this song is. Like, this is, yeah, of course, the main theme, but it's, like, definitively Florence.
I would agree with that. You hear this, it's Florence. You know what it's from if you've played the game. After that, we have music. Among one of my favorite songs on the soundtrack. This is the song that Florence first hears Krish playing on the street, and also it just sort of serves as Krish's theme. You will hear this melody show up in other songs throughout the soundtrack whenever it's dealing with a place where Krish is heavily the focus. And it's gorgeous. Man, the cello is such a pretty instrument, and I forget that all the time.
It has range, whether it's the lower notes, the higher notes. It's definitely a powerful instrument. And when you talk about soundtracks like Journey, where a cello is very prominent there, like, yeah, there certainly some inspiration must have been taken from there. An important narrative beat, an important narrative character, certainly one that had to be here.
And I think I just have a soft spot for the cello because my first crush was a cellist.
Aww. They're not easy instruments to play. I mean, not as bulky as a string bass, but...
Oh, boy, no. String basses, you need, like, a backpack to carry around. After that, we have Happy Together. Now, of course, this is the music that plays after Krish and Florence have moved in together. Or I guess, more accurately, Krish has moved into Florence's apartment. Because I don't think they get a new apartment, it's just Krish moves in with Florence. And it has this bouncy feeling to it because it'll show, like, Florence having this new vigor for this job that she still doesn't really enjoy, but they're... It's another one of those, like, really nice abstraction moments where near the beginning of the game, you do a scene where you are at Florence's work and you have to, like, match numbers because, again, she's an accountant. And that comes back in this section and the game does it for you very quickly because she's there and she's loving life and it's happening. It's another duet between piano and cello, but this one is more... They're working together in perfect harmony and just having a good time playing the music.
This is definitely another one where it's like, oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely remember this song from this game. And again, like, it's a short experience. But when certain tunes just cut through all of that and you remember this one, yeah, I really was happy to see this one on the list.
Yeah, this is a very, very good piece. But unfortunately, nothing can last forever, because our next song is Fight. So this is a lot more of a hectic piece in game, because these little like back and forths that you can hear eventually get to the point where they're happening rapidly, because they're arguing and talking over each other. And my favorite part of this song is not just that it sounds like the cello and the piano are arguing with each other, but it's also eventually gets to the point where they're not even playing the same song. At the start of the song, it's just they're echoing each other, but then it gets into it and they're playing entirely different songs. I don't think I have talked about a song for this show yet where it's this intertwined with what's happening on screen to a point where you can picture what is happening just from the song alone.
Mm-hmm. And that really shows the power of it. Like, it's very explicit, but it, yeah, it, you hear it in the sample, like it's combative and for a purpose. I mean, yeah, if heaven forbid you haven't played the game yet through our asking, yeah, you could still absolutely visualize like what's going on. And the fact that like, it just matches the pace of what's happening. Yeah, this one is, it had to be here, and it's awesome that it shows the metaphor perfectly, but it just hurts.
Yeah, it's a very unfortunate piece, a very unfortunate scene, but it's very powerful. But eventually, everything is going to come back around, because our final critical track is Wake Up, Moving On. This plays during the end of the final scene of the game, final sequence, where it shows Florence moving on from this heartbreak and growing as a person because of it. It kind of has the main theme making a return in the song, but also at some point Krish's theme shows up in the song. And it doesn't really stick around very long, because it's just sort of a part to point out that Krish's involvement in her life did in fact help Florence grow as a person. I read a review of this game while doing research that stated the ending had made them pessimistic about the prospect of romance and love. And I don't understand how that's possible.
Come on.
Because the message of the game is that when something like this ends, it's inevitably going to feel like you wasted your time. It's inevitably going to feel awful and like it would have been better if it never happened. But that's not true. I think we can both attest to that. That's not really true. You grow as a person from this kind of experience. It makes you a better human being, a more fully fleshed out adult.
Yeah, if you don't take it with you and learn from it, like, you're not doing the human experience properly. I mean, yeah, you can be bitter and, you know, say like, oh, what was it even for? But like, surely you had, you know, great memories with that person, and you learned about yourself, and you know for a possible next time, you are now more sure what you are looking for going forward. So yeah, I wholeheartedly disagree with that reviewer.
Yeah, I didn't understand what he was getting at. It was the only one that I read that said something like that. So I did want to bring that up and this song is a good time to do it. But yeah, the whole song just represents Florence has grown as a human being. She has changed. She is not the same Florence you knew when the game began.
It absolutely nails what the moral is and what the ending should have been. So they nailed it.
So, as for cutting room floor, we both have one. Hit me with yours first.
Oof, I'm sorry, I'm going to bring it down. We're going to go with moving out. Because, like, I hear this song again, and I'm like, yep, this is me right now. Like, this is my life in a song. And I love that it's C minor. Like, C minor is just a gorgeous key. It's depressing as hell, don't get me wrong. But it also has, like, it's a short piece, but it also does represent that, yeah, life goes on, whether you want it to or not. So, might as well do something about it.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a really good, that's a very good sort of moral there. Don't worry though, I'll bring it back up. We're fine. Cause I'm gonna talk about memories. Collages!
Yeah!
this is our first peek in the game at how Florence actually just wants to be an artist, not an accountant. But her mom makes her do math homework, and I feel you, Florence. And I just like this because of the flute. The flute is a fantastic part of the song.
Yeah, this is another one, like, I was really happy to... I probably would have put it on the five if I were picking it, but I'm glad to at least see it here. I think it's because, like, I spent the most time on this in the game, like, trying to make it look good, and I didn't know if it, like, had an actual impact on the story.
The collage will show up in the background of different scenes throughout the game, and it's the one you did. The butterfly one specifically is the one I saw most of the time.
Yeah, so, like, it's really clever, and I spent a long time, so, like, I definitely got to hear this song a lot.
And I, too, have been drug away from things I love for math. I feel you, Florence. You and me, peas in a pod. Which actually is a perfect segue into what will I never forget about this game? Florence and Krish are actually both my age. If we assume that Florence is 25 in 2018, then she is exactly my age. Because I am 26. I will be 27 in December. And I was 25 in 2018. And so I kind of get heavily emotional about playing these games because, and again, I think we can both attest to this, some of these steps are familiar, some of these events in the game. Obviously, you have more experience with more of it than I do, but it is a familiar process overall. And I think that a game that has a message of however bad it feels now, it's gonna get better. Statistically, how bad you feel now cannot last forever. And I think that's always an important message, no matter what the game is. It's a message that I like to try and point out to people because I deal with a lot of depression and anxiety issues. And while those aren't inherently connected to anything this game tries to teach, I think they have a similar lesson to be learned out of them.
Yeah, yeah. This game is too real. Like, I'll always remember how it struck me at whether it's the right or the wrong time is up for debate. But it's an important game to learn from. And I just play the game and have some empathy and just make yourself a better person for doing so. And I don't know how many games you can really say that about. I really applaud Florence here just for this kind of concerted effort on a mobile game to tell a specific story, to really round people out and make them really understand what not necessarily, you know, that, oh, you'll go through this, you'll know. And like, no, that's not the case. But to understand that, yeah, there is the honeymoon period in a way, the infatuation there. You know, the relationships can go this way, and there's always something to take from them. So, yeah, kudos to this game. I mean, it's important to talk about on the show, and, you know, certainly for musical reasons, but also just to highlight a fantastic game.
As for our transition, as usual, we'd like to point out we're not doing that for this one.
We tried
so hard. So it turns out searching Florence cover gets you Florence and the Machine covers, which I know, who could have guessed? And
what about Florence Game?
Adding Florence Game cover gets you a song they wrote for Game of Thrones. So here's what we're gonna do. You know what, Florence and the Machine? You wanna be my search query results so badly? Fine. Funnily enough, this is actually a thematically appropriate song, at least. Florence and the Machine remixed the song Stand By Me for Final Fantasy XV. So we're just gonna play that.
Please cover some more music for Florence.
Somebody do a performance of Florence.
Someone's got to, but here you go. You want Florence? Here's Florence.
So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand now. Stand by me. Stand by me.
All right, so we got emotional about Florence, and justifiably so. It's such a short experience, a really honed narrative that really punches you in the gut. Well, this one handles its relationships a bit differently. You know, it's almost like waifu territory, for better or for worse.
I don't know if I'd say almost like it is.
Yeah, let's be honest. You know, if you're next to them on the battlefield, you get points, and there may be kids involved. But Fire Emblem Awakening, let's talk about it. It's the 13th entry in the Fire Emblem franchise, at least the 13th one released, and it was the 6th that was known to Western audiences. The first one of those was 2003's Fire Emblem on Game Boy Advance. That was the 7th game in the series, but yet for Western audiences, that was the first to be localized.
So yeah, it's actually, I believe it's called Blazing Blade in Japan, but because it was the first game that we got, it was just called Fire Emblem. It was Final Fantasy all over again.
Yeah, right. Maybe not as crazy, but something like that. This Nintendo audience, though, was already familiar with Fire Emblem by name through, of course, 2001's Super Smash Bros. Melee on Nintendo GameCube with Marth and Roy. But since then, the West would get releases such as 2005's The Sacred Stones on Game Boy Advance, also 2005's Path of Radiance on GameCube, 2007's Radiant Dawn on Wii, and then Shadow Dragon in 2008 on Nintendo DS. There was a 2010 game on DS as well, but that was Japan only because it was a remake of the third game. But like, that just didn't come to America. Shadow Dragon, the 2008 game that we got on DS, was a remake of the very first game, the first entry in the series. But overall, the series sales had been declining. And so Awakening was posed with the threat in a way that it could very well be the last possible entry in the series if sales did not improve. And they were met with a goal of, if it didn't reach over 250,000 units sold, the series would end. So Fire Emblem Awakening was released in Japan on April 19th, 2012 for Nintendo 3DS under the title of Fire Emblem Kakusei. America would have to wait until February 4th, 2013. So 10 months later, almost a year. Europe and Australia would have to wait even further still. Basically 1 year. So like April 19th and 20th, respectively, in 2013. So they waited a whole year, a couple months after North America, though. Fire Emblem Awakening, developed by Intelligent Systems and Nintendo SPD, published by Nintendo. So what is Fire Emblem other than, you know, chess on crack waifu simulator? Fire Emblem at its basic core is a strategy RPG series that focuses on turn-based tactical movement of characters around a tile-set battlefield. So yeah, it's chess on steroids. It just gives you all these different options, but it adds on all these RPG elements in there. There's experience points, levels, skills, and also a rock, paper, scissors weapon wheel. So what there's lance, swords, and axes, and one has, you know, strengths and weaknesses compared to the other. It's like the, you know, the grass, fire, water sort of wheel for Pokemon, right? So the series is famous for the idea of permadeath. Like, that's a big thing where, you know, in the whole series leading up to Awakening, if you made, you know, wrong decisions for moving your characters around, or if bad luck or RNGesus just got the worst of you, your character would die and not return. They would be gone for the story. Awakening, however, added the idea of casual mode, where for newer players, they would just, oh, they'd be out for the battle, but they'd be back in the story and they'd come back for the next round. So this was an option that could be enabled or disabled. And of course, it's a good way to invite newer players, which they had to get for more sales. And as we mentioned with relationships, Awakening introduced the idea of character relationships by having these relationships would give benefits in battle based on character proximity on the battlefield. So if characters are next to each other and they have a good relationship level, there'd be, you know, a benefit in attack, a benefit in defense. You could maybe attack twice, or your partner would kind of take the hit for you. So you have these different options here.
Like, couples become unstoppable if they reach a high enough thing, basically, in my experience at least.
Mm-hmm. And again, it helps newer players, like we were at the time, understand the gist of Fire Emblem. Fire Emblem Awakening's tagline, apparently, in Japan for its story kind of summarized it as, quote, two sleeping dragons, one a sacred ally of mankind, the other its sworn destroyer. Two heroes marked with the symbols of the dragons. Their meeting heralds the dragon's awakening and the world's ending. Ooh, spooky. The plot basically starts, though, as a group of soldiers from the kingdom of Elise finding the customizable player character unconscious in a field, and that player has amnesia. So the player avatar, my unit, as it were, has the default name of Robin, and they can be male or female. Customize their hair, their voice, and just kind of give it your own appearance. Now, Robin shows the skills of a tactician after they save a town from bandits that hail from the rival land of Plegia, and there's also the zombie-like monsters named the Risen. So the Elysian prince, Crom, decides to take Robin under his wing for these skills. Now, a conflict is brewing between Elise and Plegia. Of course, the Risen are a threat, and there's also a masked assailant that calls himself Marth. More dangerous still is the vision that the beginning of the game teases, where Robin can recall killing Crom. Very interesting indeed. So, Joe, what are your experiences with Fire Emblem Awakening?
I've played it twice. I played it once very shortly after it got a ton of praise when it came out. And then I actually replayed it a couple of years ago in honor of a friend. I very much like Awakening. I would call it my favorite Fire Emblem. And technically, I would be correct. But considering the only other one I've played is Fates, that would not be fair.
Yeah. I think mine is very similar in a way, though I played it twice. The first time I gave up on it, like, rather early. Strategy RPGs and I do not get along well. It's one of those genres that it's like, not my favorite, not a game I could really see myself playing. Like, you know, the idea of XCOM, my enemy unknown, and that series coming back, like, nah, didn't work well with that. It's why I haven't picked up and tried Mario and Rabbids Kingdom Battle. It's like that. I know these games generally aren't for me, but something about Fire Emblem Awakening, I got back to trying. I tried it again, and something clicked. Something in the game, and it must have been, you know, the casual mode and putting it on easy and all these different characters. And sure, pair these two up. Like, I'm not gonna lie, that helped.
I think the best decision they've ever made is putting casual mode in these games. And I know that there are a lot of Fire Emblem fans that will want to stab me for saying that. But some people really like playing with the permadeath. They enjoy the feeling of it makes your decisions really count. And they like having to like reset every time they make a mistake because to them that is a punishment in itself. I don't like that. I'm just here for a story. And I like Fire Emblem gameplay. I very, very much like. I like it enough that I made it through Fates. Look, let's be real here. I played all three routes of Fates. Did not do that simply because I really, really liked the story. Because Fates' story isn't very good.
Yeah, I mean, I stopped partway through Birthright.
But like, the fact that they put in a mode that's like, all right, so you don't want to sit there and continually reset every time somebody dies. All right, cool. Go for it.
I mean, that's why it's an option too, right? Like, players aren't forced down one way or the other. Play how they want to and, you know, again, grow the audience that way. That was the point. Development on Fire Emblem Awakening began in 2010. And apparently early ideas involved a modern day setting or even Mars as a location.
What? Just
not even on possibly planet Earth, but these were seen as too alienating, especially under that big sales pressure.
I want to see that game though. Make that though.
Maybe now that the series is popular enough, maybe we'll go from an Academy and, you know, a Game of Thrones, Harry Potter like anime storytelling. Maybe we'll go to space and you can move farther because of lighter gravity. I don't know. But eventually, with all that, the idea of the sales pressure, and if this might be the last game in the series, the team decided, let's have this be the ultimate Fire Emblem game. Let's bring in all of these elements from previous games, because again, you know, it's had quite the history. This was, again, the 13th release in the main series. Apparently, the title, at least internally, the game was originally called Fire Emblem Fiend, The Children from the Brink.
They sure had high hopes.
Yeah, which it's in a way, I mean, calling it Fiend was, you know, the last one. It kind of reminds me when, you know, Fates was called Fire Emblem If in Japan. So like, you know, different title there. But yeah, The Children from the Brink, because, oh boy, children and those things that would certainly play a part in the story. The team even made shirts, apparently, that said, reset, bring it on. And, you know, just translated in the Japanese, whether it's katakana or whatever have you. But that kind of, you know, remarks on the challenge that the team had ahead of them, but also kind of poked fun at, you know, what players would do if they had a character die in battle. The game was announced to basically exist just before the Tokyo Game Show in 2011, and it was confirmed for Western release at E3 2012. A 2013 release date was assigned in a Nintendo Direct just a couple weeks later, on June 22nd, 2012, and then the specific release date was shared during a December 5th Nintendo Direct of 2012. This was another instance, like we talked about with Kid Icarus Uprising, where a 3DS game was being developed without the system being final, and without any definitive knowledge of what any possible limitations might be.
Feels like there are too many games. Two of those are too many.
But when people point out that, you know, Fire Emblem Awakening characters, why don't they have feet? Well, this is apparently the reason why. Devs originally limited how many bones a character model could have because they were concerned about possible CPU limitations. Eventually, this was revealed to not be a problem for the 3DS's CPU. But at that point, they're too far along. The lack of feet was really not worth changing. And of course, this is why it's fixed in Fire Emblem Fates.
That's the best backstory you could possibly have told me about the feet.
It's not just like, oh, they forgot and then they remembered for Fates. It's like, no, they were really concerned about the 3DS limitations before the system was out there. And then they're like, well, you know what? The top halves of characters are more important anyway. Like the faces, like that's going to be what players remember more anyway. And so don't change the character models en masse, essentially. So I found that certainly very interesting. And yeah, we do mention, you know, giving the players the option of casual mode. You know, of course it was a controversial idea. Like, you know, these developers, you know, when they're taking the series into account, like they know what the series is all about. But again, not a decision made easily, but one that had to be made to help try to ensure the continuation of the franchise. And boy, did it continue. If it weren't apparent, the game was reviewed very highly with a Metacritic score of 92. That's the sixth highest rated game of that year. And we've talked about how good of a year 2013 was for games. Like, a lot of great games came out that year. But it was a success in Japan pretty much immediately. The game, remember, 250,000 units was the watermark? In Japan, in its first week, in April 2012, sold 242,600 units. Just in that market, first week. As of December 2014, which was, you know, several years ago, it was reported that 1.9 million copies had been sold worldwide, so that number, I'm sure, has only increased since then. Maybe not by much, but still a massive success. And it's been said that the success of Fire Emblem Awakening really showed to prove the viability of the 3DS as an RPG platform to publishers like Atlus and Square Enix. Square Enix would, in 2014, release Bravely Default. And then Atlus, you know, with Persona Q or Shin Megami Tensei 4, like, it shows that the 3DS was a good platform, because in the early years, certainly there were struggles. But yeah, 2013, as far as like an award-winning kind of year, I mean, there were so many good games that year. So Fire Emblem Awakening was certainly nominated for Best RPG. At least it was at the Spike Video Game Awards. Plenty other websites had it either nominated or winning RPG, 3DS, story, soundtrack, or even nominated for Game of the Year categories. And it was, yeah, it was an especially popular game amongst our group of friends. The podcast at the time that I did Show Me Your News, when we did our Game of the Year fan-voted awards show, Fire Emblem Awakening was the Game of the Year for 2013 for that community. So, like, yeah, we care about that game a whole lot. It meant quite a lot. Interesting also to note that IGN has Fire Emblem Awakening as the number two best 3DS game of all time per their rankings, behind The Legend of Zelda, A Link Between Worlds. So it's a really distinguished, notable game.
I personally would not make it number two. I wouldn't put it below Link Between Worlds, that's for sure. I don't think I'd make it number one. No, it'd probably be number two. And I think instead of Link Between Worlds, I'd probably throw Uprising in there. But
Interesting. I mean, it's a top five game for sure on the 3DS. Like, it's one I think you gotta play on there, because it really helped a legacy of Fire Emblem going forward. And because it was so popular, there were two 3DS follow-ups that were ordered. Of course, we mentioned 2016's Fire Emblem Fates, and you know, that was a game that released with two separate Birthright and Conquest versions, as well as the Revelations DLC story conclusion. And there was also 2017's Fire Emblem Echoes Shadows of Valentia, which is a remake of the second game in the series, Fire Emblem Gaiden. Of course, there's also Fire Emblem Heroes from 2017, which is the gacha mobile game that is very popular. And of course, we are talking about Fire Emblem Awakening because Nintendo Switch is set to receive its first Fire Emblem game on the platform this week, as Fire Emblem Three Houses arrives in North America on July 26th, 2019.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to that one.
It should do well. Yeah, previewing very strongly, for sure, at least as of time of recording here. Now, Robin and Lucina were playable characters in Super Smash Bros. For Wii U, so there's a continuing legacy into Smash Bros., and then Crom joined in Ultimate, of course. There were other Fire Emblem Awakening promotions or crossovers, including appearances in Codename Steam, Monster Hunter Frontier G, Project X Zone 2, and Tokyo Mirage Sessions Sharp FE.
It should be mentioned, by the way, this game was such a huge, success. Fire Emblem is now, I think, among the top three most represented franchises in Smash now, alongside Mario and Pokemon.
Yeah, and it certainly helps when Masahiro Sakurai loves the series, so, that's a big factor as well. By the way, Tokyo Mirage Sessions, one we gotta talk about on the show in the future. That's a fun one. Mm-hmm. Fun game. The composer that I'd like to talk about this week for Fire Emblem Awakening is one Rei Kondoh. Rei Kondoh, he was born on November 14th, 1982, in Okazaki, Aichi Prefecture in Japan. Rei Kondoh, he plays the piano, and he started to learn at 3 years old. And boy, that is early, but he is an award-winning musician overall. In 1996, he won the 40th Obunsha National Arts and Sciences Contest Composition Section Gold Award.
That's a hell of a name.
it's a big title, big prizes on his website. He associates with the company Tease Music. And according to his SoundCloud bio, I found this to be quite the quote. It's very, very pompous here. Quote, Rei Kondoh seeks and desires to elevate his musical passion and talent, going after publishing his ingenious works, as well as to enlarge collaboration between his own area of music and other fields of creative arts. And boy, if that isn't selling yourself, I don't know what is. He has his own Rei Kondoh official YouTube channel, with some videos of him playing the piano, as well as some easy listening impromptu tracks. He is known for contributing to the Fire Emblem Awakening and Fire Emblem Fates soundtracks. He helped contribute to the team for Okami, and then he was the sole composer for its follow-up, Okami Den. He worked with Platinum Games a lot, helping on the composition teams for Bayonetta, Bayonetta 2, The Wonderful 101, and Star Fox Zero. He also did some work with Capcom. So again, helping with the composition teams for Devil May Cry 4, Dragon's Dogma, Sengoku Basara, at least most of the series, at least starting with number 2. And he also recently contributed to the Onimusha Warlords HD Remaster game that came out. He at least, had a big part or led on the teams for some of the Mario Party games at a certain time with Mario Party Island Tour. I think that was the 3DS game. Yes. And then Mario Party 10 on Wii U, which he was the lead on the team for those games. But he also has some experience with anime and film. So for projects like LBX, Snack World, Danburu Senki Wars, and even Resident Evil Damnation, composed for this one. So I wanted to talk about, at least mention him specifically, because it felt like many of the tracks we were pulling together had his credit associated with him. But it's not just Rei Kondoh on the Fire Emblem Awakening soundtrack. There's Hiroki Morishita and Yuka Sugiyoko. Hiroki Morishita is the composer, at least in-house, for Intelligent Systems. So he played a pretty big part in composing for this game as well. And Yuka Sugiyoko is a big name when it comes to classic Fire Emblem composing. And we'll talk about her in the upcoming couple months, because there's a game that I'd certainly like to mention her contributions towards. So don't worry, we'll talk about her. We'll talk about Yuka Sugiyoko. But also got a shout out, Hiroki Morishita, a big component of this soundtrack. But I wanted to mention Rei Kondoh because for all the games that he's contributed to, I think I associate him more with this one. And I think when it comes to the critical tracks here, We'll certainly mention like his work primarily. But otherwise, I mean, this was just a ghost town for just soundtrack information or interviews. I mean, when it comes to like Iwata asks interviews at the time, it was more for like the stories of the pressures of, you know, delivering on Fire Emblem. And, you know, this could have been the last game in the series, but not much is said on the soundtrack, unfortunately. So that said, let's get to talking about some of these great tracks here with the five critical tracks. And we'll start with Destiny Ablaze. Now, for these battle tracks, definitely going with the Ablaze versions. You know, often in the chapters here, they'll have just the regular tracks, whether it be Destiny in this case. It would be for when you're kind of navigating the map and you're planning your strategy. And then when it actually cuts into the action of the battle, the confrontation for, you know, the two forces butting heads, it cuts to this Ablaze version, which adds more instrumentation, gives it a fuller sound, maybe adds a little more percussion. So overall, I like the Ablaze versions more, and I think that's why we're mentioning it here. So in the case of Destiny here, Destiny Ablaze, it's the battle theme for chapters 5, 7, 8, 14 through 18, and 24. So like that alone, like it shows up quite a lot. And of course, these different battle tracks, they also appear in some of these paralogues where you're fleshing out, you know, the different stories for your characters that you recruit. But at least as far as the main chapter, the main story, I mean, yeah, 5, 7, 8, 14 through 18, 24. Like, that's quite a lot. And so Destiny is a pretty important one that stands out here. So it's this diligent march with the trumpets. Then it goes into, you know, a piano and string section. It just kind of shows the diversity of the instruments here and just the overall feeling.
This is definitely the one I remember the most. Well, okay, it's not the one I remember the most, obviously, as anybody who's ever listened to this soundtrack at all will tell you, but when it comes to regular battle themes, this is the one I remember the most.
It's one that certainly stands out, and yeah, I mean, these first few here are Rei Kondoh, so if you want to get a sense of like what his sound is like, what his sense and style is, at least for composing for Fire Emblem, like this is certainly it. Number two is a pretty important one, though, at least in the sort of path of this game. It's Don't Speak Her Name. Don't Speak Her Name. Apparently alternatively titled, You Bastards, Don't You Dare Speak My Sister's Words. This is just the Chapter 10 theme. And it's really important because it takes place after the heartbreaking sacrifice of Exalt Emerin.
You're not supposed to say her name.
I don't say her name.
It asked one thing of you.
you bastards. But, you know, whereas, you know, just mentioned where, like, the field has a theme and then it changes up when you go into battle or depending on who you face, it may have a different battle theme altogether. No, this long track goes through, like, the entire chapter. Whether it's the menu navigation or you're planning your moves or even battle, like, it's this heartbreaking tune that just kind of really paints the emotions of the chapter perfectly. And it's one of the few on the soundtrack that does this and just played for dramatic effect and really well done.
It's a very, very nice piece, a very powerful, melancholy but driving piece. I like it. I remember this chapter very clearly. It's one of the more, it's like the halfway point. Well, not the halfway point of the game, but very close to the halfway point of the game, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, correctly? I think there was like 25 chapters, so like close, but at least as far as like narrative, like it's a big turn.
Yeah.
Like it's important. Like, I mean, in the conflict between Elise and Plegia, like Plegia have done something unspeakable. So, you know, what are you going to do about it? Like, where's your motivation and how will you go forward? Because certain big conflicts can take place, and that's where we find our number three critical track, Mastermind. This is the battle theme when you enter the confrontation against certain players that are on the field, almost like the kings, if you will, of the chess piece. In particular, these are Gangrel and Walhart. When you confront these two characters, this song plays. They are not the big bads, of course, right? But they are formidable foes, to be sure. Interestingly enough, like these sort of big, like boss-like confrontations are all titled with words that start with M. I mean, there's another one called Monstrosity. So just something to note on the soundtrack. It's really interesting. But it, like, it's this big confrontation with vocals and these unusual horn sounds. But like, yeah, it's again, it's the big boss for the map. It's, I think, one of the more iconic sort of big boss tunes for this soundtrack.
I barely remember. Well, I, like you mentioned Gangrel. I don't remember what Gangrel looks like. I remember Walhart because Walhart looks stupid. Walhart's the one with the big horns, right?
Yeah.
He's wearing the helmet with the stupid horns.
Yeah, the red suit. Gangrel looks like Grandpa Dorf in Smash Brothers.
Now I do remember what Gangrel looks like.
There you go. Uh-huh.
Grandpa Dorf.
Yeah.
it's a really, really good piece though. Fire Emblem just has really cool songs for its bosses in general, because eventually one of us is probably going to bring Fates, because the soundtrack of that game is genuinely fantastic.
And we'll talk about Morishita probably for that one.
Yeah, probably. I more remember those than I remember Awakening, which is really weird, because I've played Awakening more than I've played Fates, but they're always very, very strong pieces.
I think it's interesting, you know, for the boss ones, you know, maybe if you're over-leveled or something like that, maybe the piece doesn't last long enough. So I wonder about that. But yeah, if you play on, you know, classic mode and you have that permadeath and instead of like the Ablaze version of the map, you get this song, like it stands out. But I think the Ablaze track I do love the most, and I think it's more iconic than anything else on the soundtrack as far as battle tunes. We're talking Conquest Ablaze. This one is done by Hiroki Morishita. It's the allied battle theme for random risen battles and also for parlay battles. So if you're doing, you know, these grinding missions against risen, because it's the allied part of the map, that's you controlling it, and it, let's just say it becomes very memorable. And it's a good thing because this is such a good song. It's always the one that comes to mind for me with this game, and its inclusion in Super Smash Brothers was just perfect. It's the one you had to pick, but it has this good pace. It has string accents and, of course, the background fury. You know, this horn melody that comes through just triumphant. Ah, such a good song. I love this one.
I think the only thing that keeps it from being the most memorable for me, because as I said before, I think Destiny is probably above this for me, is because I did so much grinding in Fire Emblem Awakening that I'm pretty sure I started to phase this song out of existence in my brain.
Oh, but it's so good, though. I was there with you. I did a lot of grinding, but I just relish in this one.
Because the instant you say for random risen, boy, I fought a lot of those.
Yeah, absolutely. I do think, though, that like if we're talking like the most iconic or the best song from this game, it would have to be our number five critical track here, Id Purpose. So yeah, another one that went into Super Smash Bros. Pretty much untouched. This is another one where it's just a theme that goes through an entire chapter. And it's the final chapter. So I think it's just without question like the one song that has to be represented from this game. It's a long one. It's a doozy of a track. But so it goes places. It has this memorable vocal riff that's here in the sample. It eventually even goes into the Fire Emblem main theme itself, playing off of that. So, they really want you to spend a long time on this map. And I certainly my first attempt at the final map, I did, and then realized it was it's just a battle you probably can't win. So just charge forward straight to the final boss. Like, just do it. Just full speed ahead. Partner up Crom and Robin. Just go.
This is the song everybody knows. You are not wrong. Like, this is when Smash came out and Awakening character, even before Awakening characters were confirmed, it was like, so Id Purpose is a shoe-in to be in Smash, right?
Yeah. You gotta be from this game.
It's such a good piece. It's such a good piece.
I think it's a strong five overall, but we do have some tracks on the cutting room floor. So, Joe, what's yours?
Mine is only half here so I can say the name. Don't you put any stock in this Destiny hogwash. Which is apparently also titled, Things Like Destiny Are Just Dead People's Excuses, which, damn. Ooh,
that's a title.
This apparently plays when you replay the intro scene where Robin, quote unquote, kills Crom, spoilers for this game that came out 5 years ago. 6 years ago, sorry. It's a very intense, triumphant piece, and I really like it.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's definitely an important moment in the game and all of the deception that is afoot. But yeah, definitely a good song. Nice pick there. I have two. I was a little torn between Destiny Ablaze, but I put this one on the cutting room instead. We're talking about Duty Ablaze. This is another Hiroki Morishita track. It's the battle theme for chapters 3 and 4. So, like, while you're still kind of getting your feet under you, especially if you're learning the game, like, this is probably the battle track that you're associating with. It's just a solid early map theme. Just overall really memorable for, starting out. Especially if you tried the game multiple times and tried to get into it. multiple times. My second one is Omen main theme. And sure, the clip doesn't represent it perfectly because it later goes on to the Fire Emblem, like sort of the recreation there of that main theme. But this opening, this Omen part, for whatever reason, like it takes place in like the opening demo sequence before the title screen. I feel like it's totally different than anything on the soundtrack, but I always associate it with this game. And maybe it's work I've done with the soundtrack in the past, or including it in, you know, game of the year things. Like, I always remember this bit, and so I feel it at least had to be on my cutting room floor for sure. So what will I never forget about this game? I think it taught me an important lesson about giving certain games second chances. If there's always the question that's asked, like, what is one game that you stopped playing but you tried again and you loved, it's Fire Emblem Awakening to a T. But for me, it didn't necessarily transfer over to other games in the series. Like I mentioned, I tried Fates. I tried it a couple times, and I couldn't just get really going in Birthright. So I'm now a little mixed when it comes to Three Houses. And yeah, we said, you know, previews are looking great. There's a lot to love there. But for me, it may be a rental at best. Like, I'm not buying it day one. Like, I'm iffy on it. But, like, it really showed me that, like, there is value in, you know, for genres that you may not be fond of or may not like, there's value in giving things another go.
I agree with that. For me, I just like that this was an introduction into Fire Emblem. Obviously, I will have to play more of them because I'm doing Smasher Pieces, and that's going to require me to play Blazing Blade, which was mentioned earlier. I'm going to have to play Path of Radiance, which I'm actually kind of looking forward to. And also, I think we're playing New Mystery of the Emblem, which I think is the DS one that we didn't get. So that'll be fun to figure out.
That's the one from 2010 with Japan, the remake of the third one, yeah.
Yeah, so I'll be playing those soon, and those don't have casual modes, so boy, we'll see how that works out.
Ooh, good luck.
But I mean, I'm told Path of Radiance can be played as an Ike solo run, so I'm not going to do that, but I'm told that's how it could be done.
Just Ike forward smash. That's a smash equivalent there.
Like we have said, or like I said earlier, we have a friend who is no longer with us, and I'm pretty sure that Awakening was his favorite game, like ever, mm-hmm. pretty much. I still remember being in Skype calls with him as he was yelling about one of the DLC maps that he just could not beat.
Oh, that was a hard one. Oh my God.
He loved Fire Emblem and he loved this game. So, and that's the reason that I played it a second time. And obviously I'll be playing it a third time for Smasher Pieces. It's a good game.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So I think in this week of relationships, be they very real and heavy hitting, or, you know, just meet, you know, pair two anime people together, you know, the different levels of seriousness there. But that will do it for this week on Original Sound Chat. You can find me on Twitter at Pete Speakeasy. Joe is over at The Dobaga. The video version of the show is on rhymeswithasia.com, the Rhymes with Asia YouTube channel, but it's that podcast version you really want. And that's over on Anonymous Dinosaur at anondino.squarespace.com. But go to Apple Podcasts, go to Google Play, whatever your podcast storefront of choice, get that MP3 version, take it with you on a run, on a drive, listen at work. We don't tell your boss, don't worry. But you know, just listen to great conversations about video game music. Got that Patreon going, patreon.com/anondino. Get on that dollar level a month, and you'll get early access to the shows, the YouTube versions. Depending on how quickly it gets turned around, last week it was very early, like up to,
it was like 5 days before, yeah, it came out regularly.
So I'm just saying, if you'd like to be a patron there, that could be a benefit there for you. We also have the Spotify playlist going. Florence should be added this week, right?
So surprisingly, yes. While researching it, look, people that do music for video games, it makes it so much easier to put together a Critical Five if I can listen to the songs at work without having to open YouTube. And yes, Florence is on Spotify. So yeah, that'll be going on there. I'm very happy about that. And I'm pretty sure so is Stand By Me.
Perfect. But Nintendo, get some Fire Emblem Awakening on there. Just saying. Do your Nintendo thing. Social media for the show, of course, is also at Soundchat OST. So you can leave us messages there. Give us feedback for how we're doing. And also games you'd like to see us cover on the show. Joe, who are we talking about next week?
I am talking about Toshiyuki Kishi.
I will be talking about Hideyuki Fukasawa. I think there's a big event coming up there. Maybe that'll give some hints as to what games we will be talking about next time. But to play us out, I will talk about a fan cover, whether it's from YouTube, OC Remix. This one comes from YouTube. It's from the YouTuber Momega, M-O-H-Mega. He did a cover of Conquest that I really like. Adding some electric guitar to it really fleshes out the sound. I think you'll really dig it too. Thanks so much for listening to this week on Original Soundchat. We'll see you next time. Take care.